Good morning. Welcome to our regular second Saturday presentation. In today's presentation, we have three parts. The first one, we are going to see the union budget highlights. Then we will have current market scenario presentation. After that, recommendations will be taken by Padmanabhan. Then finally, we will have question and answer session. First, we will see union budget highlights. As you all know, budget is an annual exercise done by the finance ministry to tweak income and expenditure of the government. Generally, during budget time, market used to see lot of volatility. Historically, if you see, means most of the time market used to go up before the budget on anticipation of government steps and huge expectation for various sectors. Post budget, market used to react as most of them used to get disappointed on budget announcement. But this time, if you see, means government has been consistently telling that this budget is going to be a once in a century budget, and they were giving huge hope to the market participants. But market was not ready to listen. Market was very cautiously positioned ahead of budget. In fact, just 1 week before the budget, market has corrected almost 7.5% in the index. But post budget, market rallied a lot. We had a historical rally of post budget in the markets. In fact, budget was very good considering the hardship seen in the economy. During the budget preparation time, generally the finance ministry team used to take the stock of the situation, how the economy is doing and how they are, what steps they have to take to make improvement in the economy, they will consider it. This time, if you see, means the our economy was doing rather poorly. If you see in the last 2 years, our GDP growth has been decelerating. This has been plotted for the last 2 years from FY19 onwards. Even before the corona was hitting us, our quarterly GDP has been gradually on the downward slope. Then the big corona COVID pandemic hit the world and we saw a steep recession in our economy. Government imposed multiple lockdowns. Almost economy was standstill. Majority of the industries and the economy was standstill during the April, May, June month. Only few crucial sectors were allowed to operate. Not only India, entire globally, if you see, means COVID disruption hit global economy very hardly. And generally, this type of events used to happen one or two times in a century. During warlike situation, this used to happen. And in a pandemic time, this used to happen. So if you see between 1900 to 2000, this type of situation happened two or three times. During World War time, this has happened. During Great Depression time, this has happened. And now, because of the COVID pandemic, the global economy has been disrupted a lot. And our economy also not in exception. If you see, means the Q1 FY21 GDP growth was almost contracted by 23%. Then slowly economy started recovering due to unlock made in the economy. And still we are expecting that only from next year onwards, economy will go to pre-COVID level. So Indian economy was doing pretty badly even before the COVID hit. And when COVID pandemic hit, it got disrupted a lot. So finance minister job was very hard because they have to bring the economy on track. Before how it was doing before pre-COVID level. So if you see historically, many economists have suggested various methods and suggestions to the government on how to mitigate this type of situation and how to bring economy on track. And one of the credible methods which has been suggested by the economy is called Keynesian economists. So one John Maynard Keynes, he is the author of the Keynesian economics. He lived during the Great Depression time, during the World War time. So at that time there was massive job loss in the economy, and he suggested some methods to the government. What he told was that during this recession time and deep depression time, government has to come and spend in the economy, because private sector will not take risk when the situation is uncertain. So only government has to spend a lot of money, and during that time government should not increase the taxes. In fact, the government has to reduce the taxes during that time. Then only people will start spending money, and the economy will start reviving. So this is basically called a Keynesian economist. He's a famous English economist and lived during the Great Depression time. And this time what government did was that they exactly the same thing. They opted this Keynesian economy to revive our economy. So government decided to spend heavily. And if you see there, the government has decided to spend heavily on capital investment. And the other very important thing in the budget is that it's a credible budget. In the past, we have seen many times that there is a huge difference between budget expectation and revised budget estimates and revised estimates. During the budget time, what they used to tell, that they used to tell that we are going to raise so much money from divestment, our tax income will go up by 25%, like that they used to tell in the budget. But if you see in the revised estimates, that would not have happened. But this time what has happened is that our tax estimates are all very reasonable. It is likely to be achieved. In fact, our tax estimates is likely to be much better than what it has been said in the budget. It's a very credible budget. And other thing is that the food subsidy, which was previously written in the in order to reduce fiscal deficit, food subsidy was shown in the balance sheet of Food Corporation of India. That has been now removed. So entire food subsidy will come in the government budget itself. So the numbers are very credible. The tax estimates are credible. The divestment proceeds are expected are likely to be achievable if LIC is get listed. So overall, it's a credible budget. After many years, we are seeing a very credible budget. The other important thing highlighted in the budget is that in the last 6-7 years, if you see, means budget used to be talked around 2 hours, 3 hours. Most of the stories they used to tell, the points would be very less. But this time, what finance minister did was that she directly went into the key points and directly told all the main points without telling any stories and other things. So in that way, it's a very good budget. And direct taxes, no major changes has been done. There is a few tweaking in the customs duty. That will not have much impact. For direct taxes, there is no material changes. And some of the bold steps has been taken in the budget. One of them is that they have decided to privatize 2 PSU banks and 1 general insurance company. So not yet they have told which banks they are going to privatize, but it's a big political decision they have taken, because historically none of the PSU bank has been privatized till now. The last bank which has been done was the IDBI bank. That too, LIC took the majority stake in it, and they bailed out the IDBI bank. Since LIC is a government institution, so we can't tell you that they have privatized the IDBI bank. And we have to see which 2 PSU banks they are going to privatize in the current financial year. And 1 general insurance company also, they have mentioned that they are going to privatize it. So it's a very bold step government has announced it. Then the other thing is the asset construction company, which will be set up to take over stressed assets of the bank. So it will clean up the balance sheet of the bank and say right step they are going to take. So government overall, if you see in the budget, government has taken a very bold step for reviving economy. There are no other options. Only way to revive the economy is to be heavily spent by the government. So they have taken the bold step. The one risk which could always be possible is the higher inflation. Because last time, if you see in 2008 time, when a global financial crisis hit the market, at that time also Pranab Mukherjee was the finance minister. He took the same step by spending heavy huge money, and they at that time also fiscal deficit went to the roof. But there is some difference between the government spending at that time and this time. At that time, what government spent was that they mainly spent for the consumption, to boost consumption they spent it. They gave the arrears of the pay commission, which were huge sum of money has gone into the hands of the people. And then they waived the farm loan. That also boosted consumption. But this time what they are doing is that they are mainly going for a capital expenditure. What government feels that is unlikely to be inflationary. In 2008-09, because of the step took by the government, it became highly inflationary. And it took almost 4 or 5 years for India to come out of that inflation. And at that time, global rating agencies were threatening India that they will downgrade our rating because of high fiscal deficit. This time we have to see, suppose if inflation goes up, means then it will become a huge risk for the government. But that risk has been taken now by the government because there is no other option for the government to mitigate the situation. So overall, it's a very bold step took by the government. But what government feeling is that because of high fiscal deficit on account of capital spending, it will be non-inflationary. Because on capital spending, what government is doing is that they are creating assets for the country. And what government feels is that once government starts spending on the capital account, means it will have multiplier effect in the economy and it will create demand. What is meant by multiplier effect means even yesterday, if you see Nirmala Sitharaman told in parliament that government spending will have multiplier effect. Multiplier effect, what does it mean? That, for example, government is going to spend money for building a bridge. Means for building bridge, they have to buy steel and cement. So once if they buy steel and cement, means then that steel and cement sector will do well because of the demand from the government. Once the steel and cement sector is doing well, means they will go for capex. And for building bridge, you need lot of it will generate lot of employment because lot of labors are needed. So government will give salary to the labors, and labors with that money they will spend for buying things. So because of spending by government, it will have positive impact on 4 to 5 layers. So for example, if government spend 1 rupee, means finally the economy will get benefit of 3 to 4 times what government is spending. That is called multiplier effect. So government feels that if money is spent on capital account, there will be a huge multiplier on economy and it will create demand. So once demand is visible on the ground level, means then private sector also will start investing. So that is the main thesis by the government. That is the main assumption by the government, that by spending heavily on the a capital side, then after 1 year, private sector also will start investing and overall economy will kickstart on a healthy way. Since global liquidity is abundant, government feels that interest rate is unlikely to go up significantly in spite of higher borrowing. Because for spending money, government needs money. The only way government can get money is through taxation or through borrowings. So now, since the taxation collections are very weak, the only way government can get money is through borrowings. And because of higher borrowing, generally interest rate used to go up. But since global liquidity is abundant, they are expecting a lot of foreign money to come into India, and overall interest rate will remain very soft. That is the assumptions they have made. And why market is jubilant on the budget? If you see on the budget day, Sensex almost went up by 2,200 points, and the very next day it went up another 1,000 points. So almost for the entire week, on the budget week, market had a huge rally in almost all stocks, from large cap to mid caps and small cap. So one of the reason why market is very jubilant on budget is that there was some rumor in the market that there will be a COVID tax or COVID cess, like that it will be there. But fortunately, there is no new tax announced in the budget. That is one of the main reason why market has gone up very sharply. The second thing is that market is very happy with the capital account spending. Because if you see in the below table, the spending by the government has been mentioned. So in FY20, that is the just ended last ended year, government has spent 3.3 lakh crore for capital on a capital account. Generally, there are two accounts government can spend money. One is on the capital account, the other is on the revenue account. Revenue account is nothing but the all the salary payments, then interest payment, pension payments, all this, then the other social sector spending, all the subsidies, all this will come under revenue account. It is not going to generate any asset for the country. The other account where government will spend money is the capital account, where they will spend money on creating assets like building bridges, building ports, spending on irrigation, and spending on drinking water. All this will come under capital account. So the revenue account is not a healthy spending, whereas capital account is a healthy spending. So market is very happy that government has increased the spending on capital account. If you see in FY20, it was 3.3 lakh crore. In the current year, that is only 2 more months is there. In that year, it is expected that government will spend around 4.4 lakh crore on capital account spending. And in the next year, almost 35% they have increased it, which is around 5.5 lakh crore. So if we see that every year, almost 1 lakh crore government has increased on capital account spending. FY20 is an actual one. FY21, that is in the current year, which is REM is revised estimates. So revised estimates means generally during budget time, they would put one figure that is called budget estimate. And then after that, they will revise it, which is called revised estimates. So FY22, the budget estimate is 5.5 lakh crore. It is estimated that next year government will spend around 5.5 lakh crore, almost 1.1 lakh crore higher than what government is intends to spend on capital account last year. Last year means FY21. So on percentage on total spending, if you see, next year government is expected to spend 3.9% on overall expenditure, almost 320 basis point higher than what it was previous year. So because of higher capital account spending, market feels that it will have a multiplier effect on the economy. Many sectors like steel, cement will do well. It will create a lot of job opportunities. And once job creation happens, means then they will get salary. That money they will spend it for buying consumer goods. There is a multi-layer of economy will start doing well. So market is very happy with a higher capital account spending. And some bold announcement like privatization of two PSU banks also, market has liked a lot, because every year government has been putting money on PSU banks for recapitalization. Once the privatization starts, means then no need for putting money on these PSU banks. That bold steps also has been very, very liked by the market. And then the final point is the glide path on fiscal deficit indicates that government is planning to reduce spending gradually over next to 4-5 years. So next year, government is planning to spend almost 5.5 lakh crore. After that, it's not going to reduce immediately, even if economy picks up. I will tell what is in my glide path in the next slide. And this is the budget details. If you see FY20, the revenue receipts has been, that is revenue receipts means the government through taxation, government has got around 16.8 lakhs. In current year, because of COVID, because of industry shutdown, the tax collection has been lower. And it is expected that the tax collection to come lower by around 1.33 lakh crore. So the tax collection when compared to last year, it is lower. For next year, it is expected that tax collection will be around 17.8 lakh crore. The capital receipts account is nothing but the money which has been mainly got from PSU divestment. On current year, it is expected that the PSU divestment will be around 50,000 crores, slightly less than 50,000 crores, and another small money will be got in capital receipt. So overall, through capital receipts, it is expected that 50,000 crores will be got. For next year, they are targeting around 1.9 lakh crore in capital receipts, mainly through PSU divestment. So one of the big ticket divestment they are expecting is the LIC listing. So if government managed to list LIC, means in that, if even if they sell 10%, means government is likely to get 1 lakh crore. Then they are they are going to list they are going to sell BPCL and Container Corporation. And what I feel is that this 1.9 lakh crore capital receipt is likely to be achievable. And total expenditure, if you see, last year they spent around 26.8 lakh crore. And in current year, FY21, because of COVID and because of no other way, government has to spend a lot of money. The spending jumped almost more than 30% when compared to last year. This is very rarely to happen. Because of COVID, government spent a lot. And government has to spend around 34.5 lakh crore. And next year, the spending is likely to be stable. So when you compare to pre-COVID level, spending is still way much, much higher than what it was in FY20. So the overall fiscal deficit, if you see, last year it was 9.3 lakh crore. The current year, 18.4 lakh crore is the fiscal deficit, almost twice than what we had in the last year. And next year, they're projecting 15 lakh crore is the fiscal deficit. So all these figures are in lakh crores. So our fiscal deficit has almost doubled in the current year when compared to last year. And because of COVID, government has no other option to spend a lot of money. They have given food subsidy was extremely high in current year. One of the reasons why fiscal deficit has gone up so much is that they have merged the Food Corporation of India debt, which was used to hide from the budget, and they have merged it in the current budget. That is why it has added almost 2 lakh crore to the fiscal deficit, and that is why fiscal deficit has been extremely high. Very rarely we used to see this type of fiscal deficit data that is jumping almost 100% when compared to year on year. And next year, they are expecting fiscal deficit to come down because this Food Corporation of India, that amount may get reduced. But overall, government spending is still on the very high side. Fiscal deficit almost 15 lakh crore. And this is the fiscal deficit. And fiscal deficit is a never ending burden for a citizen. Fiscal deficit is nothing but a debt owned by the government, how much money they are borrowing every year to finance the deficit. And if you see in the last 8 years, if you see, means FY14, fiscal deficit was 5 lakh crore. In GDP terms, it was 4.5%. And FY14 to 18, almost a fiscal deficit was almost around 5 to 6 lakhs crore. Economy was improving. That is why if you see, fiscal deficit has come down in terms of GDP. Since our economy is growing, in terms of GDP, fiscal deficit used to come down. But if you see the actual figure, it has gone up because of GDP expanding every year by 5%, 6%, 7%. The actual fiscal deficit has come down in terms of GDP in FY14 to 19. But from FY20 onwards, fiscal deficit again started going up, and very sharply it has gone up. FY20, it was 7.6 lakh crore, whereas in FY21, fiscal deficit, if you see, means almost 18.4 lakh crore. It has gone up very, very sharply, almost more than 2 times fiscal deficit has been gone up. And in terms of GDP, it is 9.5%, which is extremely high. And and very rarely we used to see such a huge jump in the fiscal deficit data. In FY22, that is the next year, government is going to spend 15 lakh crore. And in percentage of GDP, it is 6.8%. So what government has told in the current budget is that the fiscal deficit for FY26, that is 5 years from now, the deficit will gradually come down. Now, next year, they are projecting 6.8. Then after that, it will fall to 6%, then 5.5%. Then gradually, it will come down. And FY26 only, they are expecting fiscal deficit to be at 4.5%. That means in FY14, what we have achieved in terms of 4.5% of GDP of fiscal deficit, we are going to see that only in FY26. That means the government spending is not going to come down in the near future. That is what the finance minister expects, has indicated in the budget. And this is called the glide path. glide path is nothing but the reduction of fiscal deficit over a period of time. And if you see the glide path, if you see means between FY22 and FY26, fiscal deficit will come down from 6.8 to 4.5. That is, gradually fiscal deficit will come down, which indicates that government will continually going to spend money on the capital account. That is what the finance minister has indicated. So what government will do, how government will finance this fiscal deficit? See, government is if you see the previous slide, so government revenue expenditure is 35 lakh crore and revenue is almost 19 lakh crore, that is almost 20 lakh crore. So government revenue is 20 lakh crore, whereas expenditure is 35 lakh crore. So difference of 15 lakh crore, what government will do is they will borrow money. There are three ways government can borrow money. One is through selling the government bonds. The second one is they can go to international market and borrow from foreign countries. Selling government bond is the domestic. In India, they will sell government bonds where banks will buy it. Finance institutions like LIC will buy it. Even FIIs can buy the Indian government bond. And the second one is where they can take debt from the foreign countries. The third one is through small savings. Small savings means there are so many small savings schemes are there in post office and other things, where actually government will take money from that. People are putting money on small savings means actually government is giving debt to the government. So overall, if you see, means 15 lakh crore, what is the amount of fiscal deficit has been borrowed by the government? So in FY20, if you see, means government has borrowed around 7.6 lakh crore. In FY21, in the current year, government will be borrowing 18 lakh crore. And next year, if you see, the government will be borrowing 15 lakh crore. In FY14, the fiscal deficit was 5 lakh crore. That means government has borrowed 5 lakh crore at that time to finance the fiscal deficit. So every year, to bridge the gap, government has to borrow the money. So money will not come cheap. Because if you borrow money, means you have to pay interest. Right now, the interest government is giving for the government bond is 6% for the government bond. So if they borrow 15 lakh crore for next year, means if you put for say 6%, means almost 1 lakh crore interest will come per year next year. So next year, what will happen? FY23, what will happen? Means government has borrowed 15 lakh crore extra. Means then FY23. 1 lakh crore extra interest burden will come for the government. So my government has to pay the interest for the fiscal deficit. So right now, if you see, means because of high fiscal deficit, if you see the budget document, if you see, means every year interest expense used to go up, because every year government has been borrowing money to finance the deficit. So interest expense for FY20 last year was 6.1 lakh crore. And in the current year, it is expected to be 6.9 lakh crore. And next year, interest expense is going to be 8 lakh crore. Because in the current year, government has borrowed 18 lakh crore. 18 lakh into 6% means almost 1.1 lakh crore interest burden will come for that. So that has added for the next year expenses. Because of high fiscal deficit, almost interest burden has been consistently going up. And if you see interest expenses as percentage of the revenue receipts, if you see last year, it was 36%. That means for 100 rupee income, government has spent almost 36 rupees for giving interest alone. Then they have their subsidy expenses, then they have their salary expenses, pension expenses, then they have to spend on capital expenditure. So most of the money is money what government is going for interest expenses only. For current year, it's almost 45% of what government has going to get on revenue receipt is going for the as an interest expense. For next year, it is almost 45%. So because of very high fiscal deficit, government has been paying huge sum of money as an interest. And if you see the government debt, now it has crossed almost 1 lakh crore. Almost 100 lakh crore government debt has been crossed. Not 1 lakh crore, sorry, 100 lakh crore. Still, I remember that in FY14, during 2014 and 15, our MD used to take presentation at a various investor meet. At that time, government debt was around 45 lakh crore. So in the last 6 years, 7 years, government debt has almost doubled. and it has gone up more than 100 lakh crore, mainly because every year the fiscal deficit add to the government debt. That is the reason why interest payment has been consistently going up. And one risk what government is taking is the inflation risk. We have to see it very carefully, the inflation data. If suppose inflation data comes, means inflation start going up, means then it will entirely derail the government plan. And budget impact on economy, if you see, means that government is going to spend heavily on the economy. Definitely it will revive the economy in coming days, because the government spending on capital goods definitely will revive it. And companies, mainly in the cyclical industry, will see huge demand revival. Companies like in cement, steel, will see huge demand revival because of heavy spending by the government. And most importantly, we have to have an eye on the inflation, because inflation will be a key to watch. If inflation starts going up, means then government borrowing will become very difficult, because right now government is borrowing at 6% around. If inflation goes to 9%, 10%, means then at 6% government will not get money, and they have to pay higher interest for borrowing around 7%, 8% like that. Then it will become unviable for the government to borrow at a very high interest rate. Then they will slowly start reducing the borrowing amount. Then it will have a negative impact. So the inflation will be the key data to watch. The one positive thing what we can tell on this, in spite of higher borrowing, what government does is that most of the borrowing government is doing on domestic only. They are not going to international market for borrowing. That will be the key risk. Whereas what government is going to do is that they are going to borrow through internally. Most of the debt happening government has taken in India is that mostly they are internal debts. So internal debts means government always has an option of printing money, and so they will always honor the debt. Whereas if you see in many European countries like Greece, Spain and all, we had an issue in 2013 on sovereign debt default, because these countries, they had an external debt. They did not have an internal debt, whereas they had an external debt. That is why that countries faced that problem, sovereign default. But since India is most of the money India borrowing is on the domestic front, we don't face that issue. So that is one positive point we can see. The other thing is that by seeing the fiscal deficit data, we should not always worry. Because when I am studying in college during 1991 and 92, at that time, the first time when I saw the budget, at that time budget used to be presented at 3 p.m. In the afternoon, and market used to trade it till 7 p.m. Post budget, pre budget and post budget session will be there. So at that time, Manmohan Singh was a finance minister. He presented the budget. So first time I heard the term called fiscal deficit at that time. So at that time, Manmohan Singh, he told in the parliament that fiscal deficit will be 60,000 crores. So since I'm studying in college, I did not understand what is my fiscal deficit. At that time, no internet was there. So I searched in library and a world economic book was there, and I read it, what is meant by fiscal deficit. And I came to understand that it is the deficit between income and expenditure of the government, and it will be financed through debt. So I got very surprised. I became very pessimistic. Government is borrowing 60,000 crores for financing. At that time, interest rate also was very high, around 14%, 15% like that. So how India will sustain with this type of deficit? I became very pessimistic. But if you see in the last 30 years, India has grown very well in spite of very high fiscal deficit during that time. So unduly, we should not worry about the fiscal deficit, because government is borrowing 15 lakh crore. The government will broke down like that. These type of things we should not worry about, because India is a growing economy. Till the economy grows, we can easily able to manage the higher fiscal deficit amount. And this is the 10-year bond. So when budget presented, the bond yield went up very sharply. Then RBI told that they are going to do open market operation. Then again, bond fell. Bond interest bond yield fell, and it is around 6%. So we have to keep a close eye, watch on this government yield on this bond, because bond market is a very efficient market. So if there is any signs of inflation coming up, means immediately it will be shown in the government bond market. So government bond market, one has to have a close watch. If there is any signs of inflation, means then immediately market will start correcting. This is about the budget highlights. Now we will go to current market scenario. And market has done very well. And in fact, the Sensex has crossed the 50,000 level for the first time. And it's a historic level market has crossed. And the other important thing which has happened is that most of the time we used to see post-budget sell-off. But this time, market has seen huge buying, and we had a huge rally post budget. In fact, in the entire week, we had a huge rally. The first time Sensex has gained more than 2000 points on the budget day, and market has gave a huge thumbs up to the budget. The other important thing which has been happening is the entire result season. The corporate results has been extremely good, and most of the results were very supportive, and most of the fundamental analysts who were worrying about high market valuations, they will be somewhat happy that at least corporate results have started coming up. The good earnings may be because of pent-up demand. Demand happened because of lockdown. There has been huge shortage of goods. So some pent-up demand was there. There has been some restocking, as well as there has been some inventory gains. Overall, it has been a very good corporate results. And global markets also very stable. And if you see that markets, Nasdaq and Dow Jones has been doing very well. And global markets are extremely stable. And if you see in the last 1 month, if you see Sensex and Nifty gained around 5.6%. Mid and small cap, they have gained around 3.5%. So overall, it has been a very good month. Actually, we corrected around 7.5% before budget, and that entire loss has been made up. And overall, market has ended positively in the last 1 month. So Q3 results, if you see, overall Q3 results has been very good. In fact, some of the companies has gone up very sharply post results. For example, State Bank has a stellar rally post results. Market has been very happy with the SBI result. And overall, if you see, almost entire sector, the results has been extremely good. SAIL has posted one of the very good quarters after many, many years. Steel Authority of India Limited, I'm mentioning. And overall, plywood companies, they have posted very good results. Many pharma companies has posted very good results. So many infrastructure companies, L&T has posted good results. IT companies have also posted good results. And if you see the across the board, overall Q3 results has been good. Well, one or two, there has been disappointing, but overall Q3 results has been extremely good and very, very satisfying. And one of the reasons for our higher profitability is due to cost cutting. Many companies has cut cost. And if you see the IT companies, they were the major beneficiaries of cost cutting. Entire travel expenses they have cut, which has added directly to their bottom line, almost from big companies to small companies. And many other companies also have cut cost. And that is also one of the reasons for higher profitability. And many chemical companies, they have seen huge inventory gains. And in fact, one of the company called Manali Petro is a small cap company. It got a huge inventory gain. And if you see that the revenue has gone up double and profitability multiple times. So many chemical companies, they got huge inventory gains. Companies in PVC sector, PVC 5.5, they almost entire list, they all companies have bought inventory gains. And in some cases, higher end product prices also has gone up. For example, in steel, there has been a sharp increase in the steel prices, which led to higher profits for Steel Authority, Tata Steel, JSW Steel. So the overall profitability has been higher for multiple reasons, cost cutting, inventory gains, higher end product prices, and a higher volume growth. So it is across the board, profitability has been higher. The other important thing is that cash flows has been extremely strong. for most of the companies. In fact, Tata Steel has reduced its debt, and many companies in the cyclical sectors, they have reduced their debt because of healthy cash flow. Cash flow is much important, and balance sheets of most of the companies has become extremely strong. The debt equity ratio is lowest on multiple years, so which means that companies are in a position to spend money on capex. That is what it indicates. Balance sheet strong and healthy cash flows are much important than what company declares as profit, and both are very good. And overall, result season has been extremely satisfactory. And if you see the result season compiled for 1,551 companies means, so in the current quarter, sales hasn't gone up much. Whereas if you see the profitability when compared to last year, the profitability has gone up by 68%. Sales when compared to last year, it has gone up by just 2.8%. So during the same time last year, if you see, sales was flat, whereas profit has gone up by 35%. So on a higher base of profitability, most of companies has shown huge profit, and cash flows has been extremely strong, and balance sheet has become very strong for many companies. In many cases, the debt equity debt has come down, and many mid cap companies has become a cash surplus, which used to have debt 1 or 2 years back. In spite of market going up very sharply, if you see the sentiment of retail investors, they are very cautious. I used to talk with 10 to 20 retail clients every day. And if you see, almost 90% of the retail investors are very cautious. It is against what we used to see historically. Generally, when market goes up, the interest of retail investors used to go up along with the market. At the peak of the market, retail investors' interest used to be at a very heightened level. But this time, it is very different. Majority of the investors were very cautious, and they were selling and keeping cash. Most of them are not freshly buying, and many of them have sold even before budget. Most of them has sold many shares, and they are keeping cash for waiting for the correction. This used to happen very rarely in history, that when market goes up, retail investors are staying away and becoming very cautious is very rare in the market. That surprised me a lot. And if you see the mutual fund, see where there is a huge outflow in the mutual fund in the last 3 months. More than 10,000 crores of outflow is there in mutual fund. The SIP book has remained steady around 8,500 crores. So SIP, they are getting mutual funds, equity mutual fund are getting around 8,500 crores inflow they are getting. On top of it, the outflow is 10,000 crores means, that means almost 18,000 crores, 19,000 crores redemption is there. Mutual funds are facing redemption every month for the last 3 months, in spite of market going up very sharply. If you see historical data, generally when market goes up, retail used to put lot of money in mutual fund and also put lot of money directly in the market. But this time, in spite of market going up, they are very cautious. Foreign portfolio investors, money, they are continuously putting money. Though the quantum of buying has come down, still they are huge buyers. So in the current financial year, this is the financial year table, they have bought almost from April to March. So April to February 10th, they have bought almost 34 billion, highest ever in Indian history they have pumped in a single financial year. Still 1.5 months to go. So we expect some more inflow to come in through foreign institutional investors. On the economic side, there is a positivity is there. GST collection is at all-time high. Almost for the last 4 months, GST collection has been continuously going up. And if you see in the last month, GST collection has gone up by almost 10%, which is heartening. One of the reason why GST collection has been strong is the higher automobile sales, because auto is one of the big contributor for GST. And because of higher passenger vehicle sales, higher tractor sales, and tax government is getting is higher, and GST collection is giving some hope for the government on higher tax collection. And it is one of the lead indicator of the economy, because what is happening the ground level, we can see through tax collection only. because whatever things we buy, the GST we have to pay. So that GST collection figure will give an important indication of what is happening on the economy. One strange thing which is, has been happening almost all corporates, which has been mentioning in TTV in their interview, is there is the container shortage. That means for doing export and import, you need container. Through container, you have to store the goods, and then it will be put in ship and it will get transported to other countries. So what companies are facing is that there is a huge shortage of container, which is which is making exporters a difficult thing. Actually, Bajaj Auto is the first company which started telling that they are facing a container shortage, because Bajaj Auto almost sells 50% of their motorcycles in exports only, not in Indian market, through other markets like Sri Lanka and in African countries like Nigeria, Egypt. They used to sell a lot of two-wheelers. So they started facing the container shortage two months before. They told that the container shortage is the biggest problem for them. Now, one by one, many corporates have started telling that they have started facing container shortage. In fact, the goods has been lying in the port for many weeks for waiting for the container. One of the reason why there is a container shortage is that there has been a mismatch of import and export. In the last 6 months, if you see that our exports has been growing at a much faster rate than imports. In the last 4 or 5 months, there has been contraction in export and import. In fact, the contraction in import has been much higher than the contraction in export. Because of lower import from China and other things, the containers, inward containers have got reduced. As well as there has been some mismatch of container globally also. Because of that, container chain has broken down, and which led to a shortage of the container. The export containments, they are waiting for weeks in the port to get containers. So because of that, there has been delay in dispatch of goods, and container charge also has gone up. Because of shortage of container, many are ready to pay the premium. And in fact, in many ships, empty containers are coming. So for that, we have to, generally goods will be kept on the container and it will be transported to other country. Now, because of shortage of container, as well as because of export to import imbalance, empty containers are coming from ship. For that, we have to pay the money, because ships cannot be run freely. That is one of the reason why the export charges has gone up significantly. And many of them are telling that it will take 3 to 5 months to get resolved this container shortage issue. And COVID cases, it's very heartening that COVID cases in India has come down a lot, and there is no spike, there is no second wave. So it looks very positive, and we expect that things will become normal in next 2-3 months. The only state which has been seeing huge COVID cases is in Kerala. The second one is Maharashtra. If you leave aside these two states, almost balance entire states has become almost normal daily. Only very marginal of cases, only few cases are coming when compared to 6 months back. So in India, COVID cases has reduced. Globally, if you see, means cases globally also, after a huge second wave we have seen in Europe and US, there also the cases have started coming down very sharply in the last few, in the last two weeks. So we feel that the COVID will gradually die down in the next 2-3 months. Moreover, now vaccination program also have started. That also will help in containing the COVID cases. So finally, what we have to see is that we have to keep an eye on inflation. Market will see jitters when there is a sign of inflation emerging. It's not only in India, globally also, if there is some signs of inflation coming, means then the first market to react negatively will be a global market, because global inflation, there also there is a huge liquidity flowing around. If inflation comes, means then the central banks will be forced to reduce the liquidity. So inflation will be the key thing to watch, and inflation will remain threat for both global market and domestic market. that should be closely watched. Other than that, I don't see any risk emerging in the near term. And the other thing we have to see is the domestic credit growth. Right now, domestic credit growth has been extremely tepid. April to December, if you see that, the credit growth has been around 1.8%. Industry, there is a degrowth. Service also, there is a degrowth. Only because of retail loans and farm loans, there has been some marginal growth in the credit in the economy, around 1.8%. So that has to go up. So once economy picks up, means then the credit growth will start going up. So that will give one of the lead indicator of how economy is performing. So that has to be closely watched. So our take on the market is that in select pockets we are seeing excess valuations. So we are not comfortable with these very extremely high valuations. So we are not recommending that type of stocks also. We are a little unhappy with the way some of the stocks are trading. Looks like a bubble-like valuation in select pockets. But value stocks, in spite of recent rally, still they are trading at reasonable level, considering the growth likely to come in the economy in the next 1 to 2 years because of very high government spending. And another positive thing is that private weather forecast SkyMet has told that the initial phase of southwest monsoon will be very good. June, July, it will be very good. August and September, they will tell on the April 1st week. But initial forecast indicates that the monsoon is going to be very good. So we had two very good monsoon. So that the third monsoon also, if it is very good, means it will be extremely supportive for our economy. And there is a very good possibility that value stocks may become again fancy in the next 6 months to 1 year. Even to watch macro data, we have to close watchly as well as the global markets. Thank you. Now we will see the recommendations.
First, we will see the chart of the Nifty. Actually, Nifty is trading in an upward trend line. So, the resistance range will be around 15,000. As the days progress, the resistance will be higher, as it is an upward trending channel. So, Nifty may consolidate around 15,500 or 15,100 levels. And there is a possibility if Nifty breaks these levels, then we will see a new bull market. So for the time being, it will be a range-bound market. This one, then we will see this month's recommendation. First recommendation is HDFC. As you know, in the budget, the government has given more importance to housing. So HDFC is one of the leading player in housing finance schemes. So they are the market leader in that segment. So we can buy HDFC also. And there are subsidiary companies like HDFC AMC, HDFC Life, all are doing quite good. So you can buy HDFC at the current market price. The second one is Laurus Lab. It's a mid-cap pharma company, has given a very good result, Q3 results. And the management is confident of a very good growth in the coming quarters also. So you can buy Laurus Lab as an investment at this price. Next one is Action Construction Engineering, AC equipment, Action Construction Equipment. It's an economy-facing stocks. As the economy improves, a lot of construction and infrastructure activities will be there. So companies like AC will benefit the most. Its all-time high is around 202 rupees. So it's still trading around 20% below its all-time highs. So one can buy ACE. You can see ACE is high equipment along the road during constructions. So you can buy Action Construction Equipment at this price. The fourth one is JB Chemical and Pharma. JB Chemical and Pharma, it's one of the mid-cap pharma companies. The positive news is that one of the PE investor, private equity investor, has taken a stake in the company. Most probably the private equity investor, when they took the stakes, they will try to turn around the company and they will perform very good in the coming 2 to 3 years. So due to the private equity firm stake in the company, the company tends to grow more than its average during next 2 to 3 years. So one can buy at current level and hold it for the target of 1345, or you can hold for next 2 years. So it will give a very good return. The last one is SKF India. As SKF India is catered to the bearing segment. The bearing segment caters to automobile and industrial segments. So as you know that most of the automobiles have recovered very well. So the SKF's management said that they are all factories are at full 100% capacity. So they are trying to expand the capacity to next level. So they are for the next 2 to 3 years, the capacity will be improved, and the profit and revenue growth will be very good for the next 6 months. So one can buy SKF India at the current price for target of 2600. And also the bearing industries, there are only 4 to 5 companies which are in the listed place, and only one company in the unlisted place. So it's a industry which have very little players. So one can benefit from the industrial growth by buying SKF India. This is the January month recommendations. L&T has achieved the target, but due to the falling prices of iron ore, the NMDC has given a negative return. So overall return was almost flat, -5.5%. But Nifty has given a 5.69% return. So our portfolio has underperformed slightly. But most of the companies like Cipla, Maruti, JM and NMDC are good. You can hold it. They will achieve the target within 2 to 3 months. Thank you.